you're gonna start.
Good evening. Today we are going to see another spectroscopy, which is called the electron energy loss spectroscopy. This is not a special technique. These features always appear when you record any electron spectroscopy, even in XPS, UPS, OG electron spectroscopy. Whatever electronic spectroscopy you are going to measure, these peaks are going to appear simultaneously. And unfortunately, in the literature, when you are doing XPS, UPS, AES, you are not scanning these additional features and use them for interpreting the results obtained. What results you can obtain, what you have to look for, how to measure this simultaneously with the available measurements that you make is what is going to be told today. In addition to that, when this spectroscopy is well developed, okay, the features of this spectroscopy is signal intensity. We will come to it a little later. So therefore, if the signal intensity can be improved, and also the low energy, vibration energies are of the order of milli electron volts, and since our accuracy in measuring the energy to an extent of a fraction of a milli electron volt is not very good, that is why we are not using these measurements in XPS, UPS, and other things. If we can measure the XPS, UPS, and other things to a milli electron volt accuracy, then this spectroscopy can be easily understood. Why milli electron volt energy is because the energy region, okay, visible region is, as you know very well, is 1 to 3 electron volts. Ultraviolet region is the 3 to 4 high electron volts, but milli electron volts and a fraction of an electron volt are going to be associated with the vibrational modes of the molecule. So therefore, EELS, that is the electron energy loss spectroscopy, can be a substitute for infrared spectroscopy. Only thing is, in the infrared spectroscopy, you have the selection rules. Okay, only those vibrations which induce a change in the dipole moment, those peaks alone will appear. In the same way, a polarizability change will appear as an absorption or in the Raman spectrum. Raman spectrum also looks at the vibrational modes of the molecule, and infrared spectrum also looks at the vibrational and rotational modes of the molecule. EELS also can be used as a substitute for infrared spectroscopy, but that is not the only use of EELS. EELS can be also used for some transitions within the molecule. For example, if you look, if we remember well, the carbon monoxide, when it is adsorbed, the phi sigma level, okay, phi sigma bonding level and 1 pi bonding level will shift their binding energies and make become coalesced together. That is what we have seen. Now, in addition to that, the electrons in the phi sigma level can be excited to the 2 pi star level or 6 sigma level, and this loss can also be appear as a peak in the XPS spectrum of CO adsorbed on metal surfaces. We have talked about only metal surfaces. Oxide surface is also possible and other surfaces are also possible, but we have not talked about them. That is why we are not telling them. So now, we briefly looking at it, electron energy loss spectra is when you met in a electron energy loss spectroscopy, a material is exposed to a beam of electrons with a known narrow energy of kinetic energies. Okay, whereas in XPS and those things, we will be using in XPS magnesium K alpha radiation or aluminum K alpha radiation, which is thousands of electron volts. Some of the electrons will undergo inelastic scattering, which means that they lose energy and have their paths slightly and randomly deflected. The amount of energy loss can be measured via an electron spectrometer and interpreted in terms of what caused the energy loss. Inelastic interactions include phonon excitations, inter and intra-band transitions. That is what we are talking about, 5 sigma level to going to 6 sigma level and other things. Plasmon excitations, inertial ionizations, and Cherenkov radiation. The inertial ionizations are particularly useful for detecting the elemental components of the material. For example, one might find that a larger than expected number of electrons comes through the material with 285 electron volt, less energy than they had when they entered the material. If so happens, that this is about the amount of energy needed to remove an inertial electron from carbon atom. This can be taken as evidence that there is significant amount of carbon in the part of the material that is being hit by the electron beam. This is especially true when you do when you carry out an organic transformations on catalyst surfaces. Carbon deposits can be easily determined like this. With some care and looking with a wide range of energy losses, one can determine the types of atoms and the number of atoms of each type being struck by them. The scattering angle, that is the amount that the electron path is deflected, can also be measured, giving information about the dispersion relation of whatever material excitation caused the inelastic scattering. That is, you can measure this dispersion of a material on a support. In this study, mainly it is used as a vibrational spectroscopy of the vibrational motion of atoms and molecules can and near the surface by the analysis of an energy spectrum of low energy electrons backscattered from them. Why this is so thing is the infrared, you know very well, infrared directly measures the vibrational excitations of molecule, but infrared of adsorbed molecules, because of the extinction coefficient is very small, so therefore in the infrared the peaks does not appear, peaks do not appear very sharp, whereas energy loss spectroscopy is not governed by any of those selection rules, and also the extinction coefficient need not be a controlling parameter. An electron passing through a material can interact with the electron clouds of the atoms present and transfer some of its kinetic energy to them. There are three kinds of ELS. They are high resolution electron energy loss spectroscopy, which is going to be in the future as a substitute for infrared spectroscopy. Energy loss spectroscopy, core electron energy loss spectroscopy, which we just now explained with respect to the carbon deposits on the surface. ELS uses electron of from 0.1 to 10 kiloelectron volts and pass through them through a thin foil of the material of interest. We will come to it why thin foil and all things. At high energies, the transmitted beam contains inelastically scattered electrons whose energy has been decreased by amounts corresponding to the characteristic absorption frequencies in the solid. At lower energies, the reflected beam is monitored for the same transitions. Bulk and surface plasmons are principal features of this spectra. We will come to it a little later. What is surface plasmon? What is bulk plasmon? These are all collective vibrations. That's all. What we can learn from it? Electrons with energy in the range of few electron volts sample only a few atomic layers. As they approach or exit from the crystal, they interact with the vibrational modes of the crystal surface and possibly with the other elementary excitations localized there. The energy spectrum of electrons back reflected from the surface is thus a rich source of information on its dynamics. Today, it is not extensively used, as I told you earlier, but it will be used extensively in the future as we are using today infrared spectroscopy and other spectroscopies. And solids, the dynamical properties of the entity along with the selection rules offer insight into its basic structural features. Also, the vibration modes of molecules absorbed on the surface provide one with the direct information on the nature of the chemical bonds between the molecule and the substrate. I hope you know, in the infrared spectra of CO absorption, we are not looking at the metal carbon bond, but we are looking at what is the shift of the CO stretching frequency. And from that, the shift of the CO stretching frequency, we are deducing whether it is monodentate or bidentate or like that. But here we are looking at the metal carbon bond, or essentially we are looking directly the surface bond. That is the advantage there. Whereas in infrared spectroscopy, because of the extinction coefficient and other parameters, we have to do it indirectly, looking at the high end extinction coefficient vibrations, how they are shifted by the adsorption process. The instrument is essentially like any other electron spectrometer. Only thing is very good monochromator is used. In the XPS and other things, we are not using monochromator because the X-ray beam itself, the generator itself is a monochromatic radiation. So now here, cathode, lens, monochromator, lens, sample, lens, analyzer, detector. That is all. The presentation of the results is, I hope you are seeing here, the x-axis is energy loss. It can be in CM minus 1 if you are only looking at the milli electron volt transients. If you are looking at the excitations of the electrons, then it will be energy loss. Okay. And usually what we are doing is that the spectrum is measured with respect to the elastically scattered electrons. We will come to it later on. That is, the energy is not lost. That is called the primary peak. With respect to that, the last peaks will appear left to the main peak, which is the with the electrons which are not lost any energy. The problems here is you can really interpret it only if it is a single scattering, needs very thin specimens. We have already talked about it, why the specimen has to be thin layer. But because multiple scattering will occur and multiple excitations will occur, multiple losses will occur, and therefore interpretation will become difficult. Presence of plasmons, longitudinal wave-like oscillations of weakly bound electrons. This is called the surface plasmon. If it is the electrons loosely bound in this bulk, then it is called bulk plasmon. These effects are dominant in materials with a free electron structure like metals, alloys, and earthings. Then it is very difficult to align and very expensive technique, this one. Now we have already talked about Auger electron spectroscopy. We will briefly mention here. Auger electron spectroscopy is a common analytical technique used specifically in the study of surfaces. We already told you that even one monolayer or submonolayers can be studied. Surface sensitivity in AES arises from the fact that emitter electrons usually have energies ranging from 50 electron volts to 3 kilo electron volts. And these values, electrons have a short mean free path in the solid. The escape depth of the electrons is therefore localized to within a few nanometers of the target surface, giving AES an extremely surface sensitive to surface species. Due to low energy of the Auger electrons, most AES setups are run under ultra high vacuum conditions. We have already talked about it. Here we are showing you the how the signal intensities will vary with respect to atomic number, the Auger electron yield, and the XPS yield. Now here we are showing this. We will show you another picture little later. The same thing, but in a better manner. When we in the incident electron beam, then we are looking at elastically scattered electrons, inelastically scattered electrons, unscattered electrons. All of them are transmitted electrons. Now, if it is reflected back, it will be give rise to a cathode luminescence. Elastically scattered electrons will reflected back, X-rays, and Auger electrons. So the technique was developed by James Hiller and R.F. Baker in the midst of 1940, but was not widely used over the next 50 years, only becoming more widespread in research in the 1990s due to advances in microscope instrumentation. It can be used in conjunction with SEM and TEM. We'll come to it later on. And vacuum technology. With the modern instrumentation becoming widely available in laboratories worldwide, the technical and scientific developments from the mid-90s have been rapid. The technique is all able to take advantage of modern aberration correction probe forming systems to attain spatial resolutions of the order of 0.1 nanometer. We have already told you in the normal microscopes, we are only assuming that we are getting. I will not say we are getting a resolution of 2 nanometers. While with a monochromated electron source and a careful deconvolution of the energy resolution can be 100 milli electron volts or even better. This has enabled detailed measurements of the atomic and electronic properties of single columns of atoms and in few cases of single atoms. Electron energy loss spectroscopy and EDACS. I hope you know EDACS is a selected area X-ray diffraction and other things. It can be variously called EDX, EDS, SEEDS, and all those things. ELS is often spoken as being complementary to energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, EDACS, which is another common spectroscopy technique available on many electron microscopes. EDACS excels at identifying the atomic composition of material, is quite easy to use, and is particularly sensitive to heavier elements. ELS has historically been a more difficult technique, but is in principle capable of measuring atomic composition, chemical bonding, valence and conduction band electronic properties, surface properties, element-specific pair distance, distribution functions. ELS tends to work best at relatively low atomic numbers where the excitation edges tend to be sharp, well-defined, and at experimentally accessible energy losses, the signal being very weak beyond about 3 kilo electron volt energy loss. We have already talked about this. The yield goes through a maximum when the incident electron energy is varied, and we have shown that it is at 3 kilo electron volts the intensity is maximum. ELS is perhaps the best developed for the elements ranging from carbon to through the 3D transition metals, from scandium to zinc. for carbon, an experienced spectroscopist can tell at a glance the differences among diamond and graphite, amorphous carbon and mineral carbon, such as the carbon appearing in carbonates. The spectra of 3D transition metals can be analyzed to identify the oxidation state of the atoms. Copper one, for instance, has a different so-called white line intensity ratio than the does copper two. We have already told you copper one, copper two, copper three in XPS will give you more or less similar binding energies. Or silver is also like that. This ability to fingerprint different forms of the same element is a strong advantage of EELS over EDAX. EDAX gives you only composition. We will come to it later on. The difference is mainly due to the difference in energy resolution between the two techniques. 1 electron volt are better for EELS. I told you it is of the order of milli electron volts. Perhaps a few times 10 electron volts for EDAX, electron energy dispersive X-ray analysis. There are several flavors of EELS, primarily classified by geometry and by the kinetic energy of the incident electrons, typically measured in kilo electron volts or kilo electron volts. Probably the most common today is the transmission ELS, in which the kinetic energies are typically 100 to 300 kilo electron volts, and the incident electrons pass through entirely through the material sample. Usually this occurs in transmission electron microscope, although some dedicated systems exist which enable extreme resolution in terms of energy and momentum transfer at the expense of spatial resolution. We'll come to it later. Other flavors include, flavors means what are the variations of this technique, that is all. Include reflection, we said transmission ELS, this is reflection ELS, including reflection of high energy electron energy loss spectroscopy, typically at 10 to 30 kilo electron volts, and aloof ELS, sometimes called near field ELS, in which the electron beam does not in fact strike the sample, but instead interacts with it via a long-range Coulomb interaction. Aloof ELS is particularly sensitive to surface properties, but is limited to very small energy losses, such as those associated with surface plasmons and indirect interband transitions. Within transmissions ELS, the technique is further subdivided into valence ELS, which measures the plasmons and interband transitions, and inertial ionization we use for carbon example, which provides much of the same information as X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, but from much smaller volumes of the material. The dividing line between the two, while somewhat ill-defined, is in the vicinity of 50 electron volt energy loss. High-resolution electron energy loss spectroscopy, in which the electron beam is 1 electron volt to 10 electron volt and highly monochromatic beam. So you can see the incident electron beam is, if you are going to use high energy loss spectroscopy, then the incident beam is going to be 1 to 10 electron volts. ELS allows quick and reliable measurement of local thickness in transmission microscope. The most efficient procedure is the following. Measure the energy loss spectrum in the energy range of about 5 to 200 electron volt. Such measurements is quick, milliseconds, and that can be applied to materials normally unstable under electron beam. Analyze the spectrum, extract zero loss peak, that is what I said, the reflected beam, using standard routine. Calculate integrals under the zero energy loss peak and under the whole spectrum. The thickness T is calculated like this. We will not go into all those things. These are all specific things. Here, mean free path is the mean free path of the electron inelastic scattering, which has recently been tabulated for most elemental solids and oxides. If somebody wants, we will give this tabulation. The spatial resolution of this procedure is limited by the plasmon localization and is about 1 nanometer, meaning that the spatial thickness of maps can be measured in scanning transmission electron microscope with 1 nanometer resolution. Now you know very well how this 1 nanometer resolution comes in the electron microscopes. The physics of this is a very very involved thing. We will have later on. It is it can be a dipole scattering or impact scattering. Okay. This we have already seen. Therefore, we will not worry about it. Why do we use high resolution electron energy loss spectroscopy? The incident electrons are of quite low energy, a few electron volts, not kilo electron volts, and the losses are in the milli electron volt range. The primary focus of study for this technique is vibrational structure of the surface and especially adsorbates on the surface. As such, it is competitive technique with reflection absorption infrared spectroscopy. Reflection absorption infrared spectroscopy has the advantage of significantly greater energy resolution, but HERLS can study vibration features of energy right down to a few milli electron volt, depending upon the width of the incident beam. Electrons with the energy in the range of a few electron volts sample only a few atomic layers. As they approach or exit from this crystal, they interact with the vibration modes of the crystal surface and possibly with other elementary excitations localized there. The energy spectrum of electrons back reflected from the surface is thus rich source of information on its dynamics, as we know from the well-developed fields of vibration spectroscopy of molecules and solids. The dynamical properties of an entity along with the selection rules offer insight into its basic structural features. Also, the vibrational modes of molecules adsorbed on the surface provide one with the direct information on the nature of the chemical bonds between the molecule and the substrate. This is the adsorption bond itself is studied. Two scattering modes are observed, differentiated by the mechanism by which they differ. One is the dipole scattering. This is a long range thing. Another one is impact scattering. This is a short range scattering process from the ion core. The scattering is more isotropic, not in the specular direction, but rather else everywhere. But the energy losses still reflect vibrational excitations in the adsorbate. The angular distribution of the peaks around the specular reflection can distinguish between peaks which result from different scattering modes. Dipole scattering is dominant. Surface vibration are more than adsorbed molecular vibration. When atoms adsorbed on the surface, new vibrations will occur. We have already seen when I adsorb CO, we will have a new vibration of the MC bond. The interpretation of the high resolution electron energy loss spectra follows that of reflection absorption infrared spectroscopy. Bear in mind that in reflection absorption infrared spectra are cast usually in wave numbers, while HRELS are in milli electron volts. 1 milli electron volt is nearly equal to 8 cm minus 1. The resolution in reflection absorption infrared spectroscopy is typically 0.25 milli electron volts. Okay, so that means nearly 2 centimeter minus cm minus 1, while it is around 20 milli electron volts per, that is the problem here. Okay, so I hope you are able to see 0.2 milli electron volts is the accuracy resolution in infrared spectroscopy, whereas 20 milli electron volt or greater than that is, by comparison with the reflection absorption infrared spectrum, spectrum of the same material taken both by reflection absorption infrared spectrum and the HERLS is shown, we will show that. Note the additional spectra given here demonstrating the molecular information available. So here an adsorbed atom that sits on a hollow site. Okay, I hope you are able to see. This is the adsorbed atom. These are the surface atoms, substrate atoms. Okay, so therefore this is the hollow site. This is the site on which the adsorption takes place. Fourfold symmetry and threefold symmetry. Okay, I mean both cases the adsorbed atom is in the under hollow site. This type of the vibrational the site occupancy can be distinguished. Here we are showing you electron energy loss spectrum of nickel 1111 and platinum 11 surface, each covered with half a monolayer of CO, which orders into C times 4 into 2 over layer. Okay, I hope you understand. You can see here one. This is 1, 2, 3, 4. So therefore, the second molecule is here. So if you in one direction it is 4 units, in another direction it 2 units. That is why 4 into 2. And then the center, there are molecules absorbed in the center. Okay, this is this notation comes from the lead spectrum, lead observation, not lead spectrum, low energy electron diffraction. On the nickel surface, the possibility for the positioning of the two-dimensional CO lattice on the surface consistent with the single type of adsorption site is to place the all CO molecules on into two-fold bridges. By similar reasoning, half of CO molecules must occupy on-top sites on the platinum 111 surface. This example shows how powerful the in-situ comparison of the vibration spectra and diffraction pattern can be, since a quantitative structure analysis is achieved without analyzing diffraction intensities. You see, we have already talked about it, that the adsorbed carbon monoxide forms a 4 into 2 structure. So the x-axis is electron energy loss. So therefore, the energy loss corresponds to certain peaks. We will see it in a minute. Here we are showing you reflection absorption infrared spectrum and HERL as a vibration spectra of acetone nitrile on copper 111 surface at the 100K. The reflection absorption, this is the reflection absorption spectrum. Spectrum B, I hope you are able to see the reflection absorption spectrum, cuts off at 800 cm minus 1. Okay, that's all. Due to the frequency cutoff in the detector, whereas HERL span can record to zero loss. You can see zero loss and then the loss peaks here. The infrared spectrum also gives the energy loss spectrum. These are the reasons why the two techniques are often used together. Electron energy loss spectroscopy, here we are showing you oxygen coverage at various coverages, 0.6, 0.3, 0.2 and 0.6. Okay, so the example feature of the HERL spectrum due to surface phonon scattering from the peak at 56 milli electron volts from the silicon 111 2-into-1 surface prepared by cleavage in vacuum at a primary energy of 5 electron volts. Primary electron beam is 5 electron volts, has been ascribed to such a scattering. Note the rapid damping of such a peaks on exposure to oxygen. Now, supported metal catalysts, metal clusters. In recent years, HERLS has been shown to be applicable to the study of catalysts consisting of small transition metal clusters supported on oxide substrate. The surface specificity of the technique allows one to probe those vibrational modes associated with the bonding of the adsorbate of interest to the small metal particles. In contrast to work on single crystal metals, one is dealing with the following new issues: possibility of electron beam charging the oxide support, strong optical phonon modes present from the oxide, diffuse elastic scattering due to rougher nature of the surface. We will illustrate some of these effects in the discussion of the adsorption and thermal evolution of ethylene. Okay, if you are interested in. So, however, as we discussed by Layer et al., such charging can be dealt with by secondary electron beam. We find that the elastic scattering from these surfaces is quite diffuse, leading to specular intensity, typically reduced by two modes of two orders of magnitude compared with the single. All these things are very great explanation. The extinction coefficient is less, that is all. It has therefore been explained that impact scattering is the dominant mechanism for most adsorbed modes detected on these systems. These modes 600 and 900 cm minus 1 in figure 3 are due to dipole active surface optical modes that are well known in high resolution electron energy loss spectrum from oxide surfaces and are only partially screened following platinum deposition in this study. When the platinum is deposited on a support, then the oxygen losses will be diminished. The screening, however, is sufficient so that undue interference from these modes is eliminated. We said that we will show the ethylene spectrum. Ethylene on a 3.4 into 10 to the power 15 atoms per square centimeter coverage of platinum on alumina film. A is I hope you are able to see a clean surface. B is ethylene at 195, and C is ethylene diene at 325. I hope you are able to see the additional peaks of CO and other things. So ethylene and C2H3 on platinum and alumina. So you can see the energy loss spectrum, energy in terms of the centimeter minus one units are given here. This is the clean platinum on alumina surface. This is the ethylene adsorbed surface. We are subtracting the platinum surface and also the molecule that will be formed when I adsorb ethylene. Ethylene can dissociate and give rise to C2H3 and H. So you can see that all these peaks are appearing, and you can see that the intensity of the peaks are also very good, not like infrared spectrum. So we have only shown some typical examples. There are many more examples to be shown. If time permits, we'll talk about them later on. As you all know, we are going to have our orientation program from the 27th of November. So therefore, we will close these presentations for some time till the course is over, because when the course is running on, I will not be able to concentrate on this and as well as that. I hope you will excuse me. So we'll come back in the middle of December or end of December. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, we can ask now. Any questions? Yeah, the question is in the last slide, the x-axis has the units of cm minus 1. I told you this is mostly used as an infrared spectroscopy, a substitute for infrared spectroscopy. infrared spectroscopy is the x-axis is CM minus 1. So therefore, in the same way, in the energy loss also, you can calibrate the energy loss into CM minus 1. It is only a computer program. So therefore, we have already shown to you that 1 millielectron volt is around 8.02 CM minus 1. Therefore, it is easy to convert the x-axis in energy loss or in CM minus 1. So you, since many of us are familiar with infrared spectrum, therefore, if it is in CM minus 1, it will be easy for us to identify the peaks. That is why it is given in CM minus 1. I hope I am clear in this. These are all simply manipulation of the results. In whatever way you want, you can do it. If you want to interpret it in energy loss, you can give energy loss. If you want to interpret it as vibrational frequency, then you can use it CM minus 1. The question is, why does we need very low temperatures for ELS? That is not true, but the intensity of the peaks, the observation of the transmission will be better if you do it in low, because it is, has to be in very high vacuum because of the low energy electrons are going to be measured with very high accuracy of the energy loss. So therefore, the vacuum must be very high. That is one of the reasons why this technique is not powerful. If, when the vacuum has to be high, it has to be low temperature. The sample should not be degassing anything. The residual pressure should be of the order of 10 to the minus 11 torr or even better. Whereas the residual pressure normally in XPS and other things will be of the order of 10 to the minus 8 torr or slightly less than that. The same logic is used in the field ion microscope or field electron microscope, because the temperature has to be low so that the vacuum will be better. When the vacuum is better, then the mean free path increases. Therefore, the energy is, the electrons are traveling to the screen better, screen or detector. So I will take this opportunity to thank you all for this putting up with me nearly about 4 months or 6 months. Okay, we are already 23 lectures are there. So nearly 5 to 6 months on this course. Thank you very much. Hope we will be back as soon as possible. If any one of you have time, you can come online during the orientation course and then talk to the students. Maybe you can mail me so that we will provide a slot and then talk to them on online. Especially those who have attended the orientation program, they can tell them what is the meaning of this orientation program. Because many of us think orientation program means it is a paid holidays. It is not like that. I hope you, many of you might have realized that it is means a serious business. Without any time left to you to think or sleep or whatever it is, to chit chat and all those things. Because if you have time, you can speak to them. Would you like to do? Okay, you send me a mail, maybe one day before or something like that, so that we will arrange online presentation. If that is possible for you. You can talk about your work or what you can talk about your impression about the orientation program, anything you want. Maybe some 15 to 20 minutes or 30 minutes, whichever time you want. Because I want these two, the new research scholars. I hope you, this orientation program has been doing not so good, but it is doing some good to the research scholars. So this must be, my time is coming running down. Maybe this is the last year I will be able to do that. But anyway, the future generations have to take over and do this. Those of you who feel that this orientation program is useful and also useful, I will not say, it is educative. If you feel, then you can impress upon them. This is also this online course is also an education for me, because now I know very well how to reach people throughout the world. So therefore, you should not think that I am only giving it to. I am also learning from this, and also I can use my time effectively to prepare this and all those things. For example, one presentation means I have to prepare so many slides. Honey, are you there? Our orientation program, and the new program, this year's program starts on 27th of this month. Maybe, I do not know whether anybody is coming from Kusat. Do you want to speak to them on online? Okay, it's all right. Doesn't matter. Maybe they may think that it is not it is a waste of time, because it is 3 weeks one has to spend. Because you send me a mail any day. You, as you know, we don't have. Okay, it's all right. As you know, we have all the days are working, even Saturday and all. Okay, thank you. Because convey my regards to Rana. How is he? Very good. Okay, thank you very much. We'll meet maybe end of December or we will email you when we are starting the same course. There are many more techniques we have to do. We have not done low energy electron diffraction. Many other techniques we have not done. We will, if you have time, we will continue this later on. Already we have done about 25 lectures. We will do many more lectures on this. Thank you very much.